Right. Good morning. All right, let's try one more time. Good morning. Now, just really quick, and I'll wait for you guys' attention. Thank you. Thank you guys for coming straight on over. Obviously, we wanted to get you guys in here quickly, and then obviously they're sitting down in the front. Thank you. That's totally fine. Today's an important day, and just to front load you guys too, we want to make sure that the time that we spend here, we are spending thoughtfully. So do not worry about the bells, do not worry about anything else. We will be the ones that will tell you guys when it's over. And we've already kind of given your next period teachers a heads up. They already know that you guys are going to be coming in as soon as this is over. So don't worry about the bells. Focus in on really what today's importance is. And the topic today is really going to be presented to you guys by the speaker that we have partnered with Newport Beach Police Department on bringing today. Talking about some of the things that we obviously see on a day-to-day basis from our pressures. And that's a lot of anxiety that comes from the pressures that exist in the community. So without further ado, introduce to you guys our very own Officer Clemente.
One of the core values at CDM is resiliency. Whether I'm speaking to your parents at PTA or to you guys right now, this year you guys have clearly demonstrated resiliency. I know the majority of you are making good life choices and that I'm preaching to the choir. However, 6 months from now, seniors, you'll be at college. You won't have the watchful eye of CDM. You won't have the watchful eye of CDM or your parents to monitor your behavior. This program is a collaborative effort to empower you with the tools necessary to be well-informed about the decisions you make and the permanent consequences they could have. Now I'll tell you about our speaker. The Kieth Sommers Foundation is located in Los Angeles, California. It's comprised of a group of people preparing young adults for positive futures. Today, the founder and COO of the Kieth Sommers Foundation is here. Kieth is also a working actor, a voiceover artist, and a powerful motivational speaker. Kieth was born in the 60s and raised in the suburbs of southeastern Pennsylvania. Today, his mission is to effectively change the future of our world, beginning with a piece of our society most responsible for our future, the youth of today. Without further ado, my friend, Kieth Sommers.
Choice decision, marry my father, be mother matriarch of our family, or enter the convent. Yeah, that's right. My mom was going to be a nun. So you guys are smart enough to realize that I'm standing here today for one reason, that my mom made the choice to marry my father. I have one brother. His name is Joel. He's a year and a half my senior. And Joel and Kieth are 180 degrees different. And we're talking at the most fundamental levels. I believe that human development happens very much akin to an astronaut on a trajectory. Specifically, however old you are when you experience a major life traumatic event, being raped as a child, being beaten, being physically, emotionally abused, having a loved one beaten in front of you, killed in front of you, going through divorce, having a loved one being incarcerated for a long time or for a life sentence, or being put to death. Going to bed hungry, not having shelter, not having clothes, not having shoes for your feet. These things experiencing on this earthly plane cause a shift in our perspective and our perception. And what that does is, number one, we're the last person to realize that occurred in us. But it manifests itself as evidence that something happened internally, and things like childhood obesity, cutting oneself, what they call a cry for help, attempted murder, attempted suicide, acting out. Some of you may have heard these phrases uttered into your eardrums by people my age or older. What's wrong with you? Stop acting like that. Sit up straight. Will you be quiet? Will you behave? Wait till I get you home. Do you know what you just did? These forms of acting out are little gentle cries for help. See, I learned in my 53 years on this planet, the greatest strength we can ever display is admitting how weak, how vulnerable, and how riddled by fear we really are on a daily basis. So that I'm not speaking from my ass, I'm speaking about personal experience, let me give you a little bit. Pick up what you want and leave the rest. I encourage you, listen for the similarities, not the differences. When Kieth was in the second grade, Kieth got off the school bus. He goes to the front door of his home, and he pulls on the screen door frame. Mom, open the door, mom, open the door, mom, open the door, mom, open the door. My mother's on the inside preparing the evening meal. My mom basically had two jobs. One, she was in emergency room and operating room registered nurse. And she was mother matriarch of her family. So when I asked my mom to open that front screen door, while she's preparing the evening meal, I didn't take any of that into consideration. All I know is Kieth needed to get inside. Kieth, what's wrong? Mom, open the door. Mom, open the door. She unlatched it and come barreling inside. She said, Kieth, what's wrong with you? I'm like, Mom, just leave me alone. Kieth, baby, what's wrong with you? Mom, leave me alone. She grabs me by my face, looks in my eyes, and says, baby, what's wrong with you? I asked my mom a life-defining question. I said, Mommy, am I white? Why would you ask me that? Well, Mommy, the black kids say I'm a gray boy, I'm a half-breed, I'm a zebra, I'm a mutt. Mom, my hair is not like them, I don't dress the way they dress, I don't live where they live, I don't talk the way they talk, so Mom, am I white? Oh, baby, wait till your daddy gets home. Well, Arthur, my father, comes in from the aerospace job at Lockheed Martin. My mom says, Arthur, we need to talk to Kieth, please. Okay, Kieth, go upstairs to the master and wait for your mom and I go up to the master bedroom, I take my position on the bed, they come in and they shut the door. My dad steps aside and goes, so what's the problem? My mother tells my father what I asked her after school that day. My mother and father proceeded to impart their pearls of wisdom. They proceeded to tell me how I got these features and characteristics and attributes from the African-American side of my lineage. And my mother did the same thing with the Italian East Indian side of that side of the family. If you've ever heard an adult speak in a Charlie Brown episode, womp, 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 womp. That's all I heard. But most importantly, I suffered an emotional detachment from my own biological mother, father, and brother. From that exact moment, I was no longer emotionally connected and didn't even know it. I looked at my own biological mother and father and brother and saw nothing but differences and very little similarities. And what happens when you're at that age that I was in the second grade? And you suffer emotional detachment from your own biological family? You start flailing like an astronaut with his tether cord cut. You don't know where you belong and to whom you do. I had no knowledge that I was flailing. But when I look back and play that tape back, I can see it clear as day. It manifested in ways like childhood obesity. How fat were you, Kieth? I'll answer that question. I was so fat, guys, listen to this. I was so fat, I couldn't play football. Right? Who knew there was actually a weight class for football players? I was so fat, I get into this locker room, they put me on the scale, the coaches would huddle amongst themselves, and I hear the thing upstairs. Kieth, come here. I go over and they say, Kieth, you can't play today. Why, coach? Your weight bar. Well, Kieth has to take off his helmet, his shoulder pads. And I had to turn my jersey inside out and put it back on. So we went out on the stadium field and I wouldn't throw off the statistician up in the booth, keeping stats. And then I'd sit on the sideline next to the water boy, next to the Gatorade. And then have to look up at the bleachers at my dad's mother and father, my mom and papa. And they're like, Kieth, why aren't you going in? How does a little boy look up to his grandparents and say, I'm too fat to play with other kids? See, what we call that is known by the acronym, PAID. PAID stands for pitiful and incomprehensible demoralization. Where I'd rather be dead than experience that emotional pain and trauma at that exact moment in time. But I had to go on. By the time I was about 15 years old, Philadelphia decided to start a TV show and they wanted to call it American Bandstand. But see, that show was already in existence by a guy named Dick Clark. And Dick Clark Productions precluded Philadelphia from reviving that TV show. So they started another show called Dancing on Air. And I became what they call in modern terminology, a childhood celebrity. I got to pay big money to jump up on stage and shake my groove thing up and down the Eastern Seaboard. And then I'd get off stage and go and sign autographs and have people steal my clothes because they wanted to associate with me. Once again, I was a short little fat kid that nobody wanted to pick when they divided up the gym class. That me and Stephen Gabby, the kid with asthma and birth deformities, were the last two to get picked on their teams. I'm now starring in a TV show where little new artist by the name of Madonna had her very first TV appearance on our show. And another little guy from Minnesota by the name of Prince Rogers Nelson got the star on our show. I was on that show for 3 years, and then I transferred that celebrity, that fame, to dancing with Philadelphia Civic Ballet Company and Wayne's Jazz Dance Company. Because see, when I saw myself on that TV screen, I hated what reverberated back at me. So I treated that, and I'm so thankful to the modern technological advancements of terminology, because now I know what it was, how I treated that obesity. They call it bulimia. That means I open up a can of tuna, I ingest it, I take these two fingers and I throw it up into the rose bush in the backyard of mom and dad's house. Meals have been done for the day. So by the time I'm 17 years old, looking at graduating high school. Am I going to go to Philip College and perform in creative arts? Let's see, if I get a four-year degree, all I'll be equipped to do is teach. Nah, I'm better than that. So I had a mess with the Civic Ballet Company in Waves, and then a little mail chute called Chippendales in New York City. And then after 3 years of doing that, I looked at my mom and dad and said, we need to talk. They're like, sure, Kieth, what's up? I said, yeah, I need to go to this place called California. Son, what are you talking about? That's crazy. Well, mom, dad, see, I need to do this thing called perform. Oh, Kieth, that's just a hobby. You can't do that for a living. Did you not drive me to my event and have to drive a mile away because the fans were stopping the car from reaching the venue? I can do this, Dad. I can do this. Look, Dad, I've already made my decision. I'm 18 now, so I'm going to make this choice. You either support me or not. So my dad took me to AAA, and I got a road map. And he highlighted the route to Southern California. And one of the last things I told my mother and father in October 1986 is the next time you see this face, my name will be next to a gold star in Hollywood Boulevard. So I got a nice 79 Camaro Z28. I fixed my hair like Prince in the purple rain out. And I put on the Mr. T starter kit around the neck. And I got behind the wheel and I drove to California 3 calendar days. But the spirit of full disclosure, when I came to California, I didn't come alone. I came with 2 Ziploc bags full of Maui Wowie gold marijuana, to the new generation is known as chronic. 2 Ilford canisters, film canisters full of rock cocaine. And a half gallon vodka bottle, top shelf vodka called Pop-Pops, in the trunk of my Z28. And when I got to California, I was told, get a place in Hollywood, Kieth, because there's rent control there. They didn't tell me it was a 2-year waiting list. So then I went all around Santa Monica and Marina Del Rey and Venice looking for a place, and I landed back in Hollywood where I took residence. I did a little bit of acting, but see, I needed a real job. So I ended up doing security work at the ABC Studios. And I got a graveyard shift because, I don't know about you, but I had a problem with on-site supervision. I just want to be left alone, leave a brother do his thing, you know what I mean? So I would work graveyard shift, and I'd smoke my smoke, and snort my snort, and drink my drink, and hey, I'm not hurting anybody. And then I'd go back and sit in the booth and smoke a little bit more and write my little log, and I'd get out and I'd find 14 skeleton keys and register my detox clock to register the location and time that I made my rounds. That's when they came up with the term guard rounds. And then, the second day on that job, I called the supervisor pull up. I said, dude, how do I get to do your job? He said, why? I said, I hate this, man. Walking around the lot for skeleton keys, dude, I want to do your job. You get a nice warm card, drinking coffee, eating donuts, I want to do your job. Well, Kieth, see all this stuff on my belt? Yeah. Well, it comes with more money, more responsibility. Well, being the narcissist with the inferiority complex that I am, I consulted this old historical document called the Yellow Pages. Within 24 hours, I was enrolled in the Southern California Rapid Transit District Police Academy. I was going to get a thing called a Peace Officer Standard Training Certification, 830.6 PC, where I could work in a money room where all the money gets pulled in from all the buses. Folks, I don't know about you, but I was born for greatness, not to work around a money room, unless it was my money. So 2 weeks before I graduated, I'm now working on Rodeo Drive in Beverly Hills. A little short Irish Englishman named Elton John comes in, and he needs to buy some bling because he's opening up a new venue in Universal Amphitheater. So I ask his bodyguard, excuse me, how do I get to do your job? He goes, well, he opens his blazer and shows me a gold LAPD retired badge. He goes, I'm a retired officer. I said, well, cool, I'm graduating the academy. Can I get a car? Not even 2 weeks goes by, I shot a resume. I got hired. My title, Executive Protection Specialist, AKA Bodyguard. Ironically, the same person came on my TV show, Madonna and Prince, I'm now getting tasked with the responsibility of guarding them and their lives. And the Sinead O'Connor, David Hasselhoff, and my most illustrious clients, Milli Vanilli, and now working with them full-time around the clock at their homes and their estates. And my job is to protect their life and their family, making more money than my mother and father combined. 1992, in November, I met a guy named Chucky Booker, who was Janet Jackson's producer for Black Magic Tour. He had a number one album in 92 called Games. Top of the billboards, world renowned. He was going on a 6-month promotional tour, and he hired me to be his executive protection specialist. My compensation rate was $6,000 per week per diem. That means I don't get to spend my money. I get to live the life I've always aspired to, without using my own dead presidents, my own monetary means. Not even 48 hours later, I go to a famous nightclub called the Roxbury on Sunset Boulevard. I went out with some friends there and I said, you know what? I'm not feeling this vibe, guys. I just want to go home and shoot pool. So 12:30, I went down the back VIP stairwell to get in my car and I saw a friend drive around the horseshoe driveway. He says, Kieth, man, go back up. Sit at our table. So I said, cool, let's go back upstairs. So I had my vodka and my kamikaze, my Heineken, and I was feeling okay. Not great, not bad, just okay. I knew the owners. I get to park right by the front door, keep my keys with me. And at 2 o'clock, I'm asking people I'm sitting with, what do you guys want to do? I don't want this night to end, man. Let's keep this party going, huh? You guys cool with that? Sure. All right, look, I have a house, a guest house in Silver Lake Estates. I live down on Dodger Stadium, down on the city in Glendale. I'm rolling. Well, Kieth, I just closed escrow in a house in Bel Air in the hills. I think we should go there. We are a little bit tipsy. We're drinking. Let's go there. Let's go there. So I go down and get in my Jaguar XJS V12, my dream car. And I drive 1 mile down Sunset Strip, Sunset Boulevard, West Hollywood. And I'm following Drew and his Mercedes AMG because he's going right around where Tower Records is and was. And as I'm driving down Sunset Boulevard, right where Tower Records is, I go around the bend of Horn Holloway and my car goes across a double yellow line. I hit a Chevy Chevette almost head on. I instantaneously killed the 19-year-old driver behind the wheel of that Chevette. The steering wheel impaled his heart. Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office evaluated my case file, and because 6 months earlier, during the Rodney King, Reginald Benny race riots of Los Angeles, I went out to Thousand Oaks Red Onion and incurred my very first DUI, non-accident, non-injury. So 6 months later, November of 92, when I drank and I drove, and accidentally crashed my car into another, tragically ending that 19-year-old life, L.A. County exercises discretion and charged me with murder in the second degree. The term of incarceration I was facing by the charges levied against me was second-degree murder, life imprisonment. Let's be clear what that means. Life imprisonment means just that in California. There's 35 lifers in the state of California penal system that will never be free. The term is called pine box parole. That means toe tag, pine box, foot first is the way of exiting the penal system if you get convicted. 9.5 months I sat in Los Angeles County Men's Central Jail, fighting the charges for murder in the second degree, facing a life sentence. How did this happen to me? I was a Cub Scout. My mom was a den mother. I was a Boy Scout. Instead of being an Eagle Scout, I went to the U.S. Air Force Emergency Search and Rescue Department, Civil Air Patrol, for 2 years, voluntarily. I was a security guard. I went to the Peace Officers Training Academy. I went straight into the private sector, never went on the police department. But I wasn't a bad person. But they're charging me with murder. Penal Code 187. How did this happen to me? When they put me in Med Central Jail, they said, Mr. Sommers, we cannot keep you here in booking front. We have to house you. I said, but wait, my people were bailing me. Mr. Sommers, you just need to listen. You can't stay here. We have to house you. So as they're taking me to my housing in Med Central Jail, three deputies get in front of me and press me against the wall, and they put their back to me. I said, well, what's going on? They said, we'll explain in a minute. What they ended up telling me is the person who they were bringing by an escort was a guy by the name of Richard Ramirez. He was down from death row in San Quentin trying to close out other cases that matched his M.O. on how he killed other human beings. So as security, they protected me and shielded me from this mass murderer. I get put in high power. I have a red wristband on my right wrist. What that signifies is I am the highest custody inmate in Med Central Jail other than the death row inmate, because I am facing murder, imprisonment, life sentence. Not even 24 hours later, I asked the trustee, the inmate janitor, can you please go get me a razor because I need to prepare for my court appearance. What he did not know, I wasn't going to shave shit. I was going to open up that razor, take that blade out, take my carotid artery and end my life. Because you see, Art Arbola didn't make Kieth for this. They didn't put me in my mama's womb for 9 months to go to prison for life. For killing another human being, someone I never met, someone I never wronged. But this is my reality, brothers and sisters. I'm going to be locked up for life if I don't meet these charges. No, I can't live like this. You don't understand. I was a fat little obese kid that was a last kid. I can't go on like this. The cheerleaders didn't give me time of day until I became a celebrity. I can't go on like this. How will I survive? Half black and half white, where am I going to fit in? Nine and a half months later, LA County District Attorney got their conviction. I got sentenced to California State Prison for life. They said me to California State Prison, Lancaster, a level 4 institution, the only level 4 institution in Los Angeles County proper. That's where they send male inmates who are going to draw their last breath in a prison cell one day. I arrived during a black, Hispanic, racial lockdown lasting 6 months. When I arrived, the porter, the trustee, the inmate janitor came up to me after he gave me my new arrival fish roll and kit and said, stop, cuz! Brothers and sisters, when I turned and looked at this guy, my head went right into the center of his pecs. He was twice the size of Dwayne The Rock Johnson. Another life. Hey man, that was popping up in this motherfucker, don't you hold me? What? Hey man, it's going to pop it, don't you hear me, cuz? 6-3, homie!
What?
Body bags, nigga!
Body bags? What are you talking about?
What he was trying to eliminate is the fact that the body bag count between the black inmates and the Hispanic inmates was 6-3. That means 6 dead Hispanics, 3 dead African Americans. So you see, when those gates rack in that penitentiary yard, they're coming for me, because I'm a new arrival with a life sentence. They're going to get their stripes, they're going to get their teardrop on my hide. The Cub Scout, the Boy Scout, wannabe Eagle Scout, Emergency Search Rescue Civil Air Patrol, Academy trained kid, doesn't matter. I'm a convicted murderer, felon, the worst human being to walk upright on the planet. Who cares? During that 6-month lockdown, I learned things like how to make a sword with state newspaper and state soap and cold water. I learned how to sharpen a golf pencil and project it through the barrel of a pen with deadly force. I learned how to kill other human beings in a thousand ways. The person who was making his income protecting and saving lives. That's what my life had become. Through the love and support of my mother and father, I challenged that conviction for murder. Through all 3 state courts, Superior, Appellate, Supreme, conviction was affirmed. I went to the U.S. District Court again, same result, conviction affirmed. I had one remaining option, and that was to avail myself to the analysis of the California Board of Parole hearings and try to derive my eventual release on parole. 10 years I was incarcerated with a life sentence before I made my appearance January 3rd, 2002 before the California Board of Parole hearings. I made sure I did everything I was told to do and not one thing I was told not to do. I, unheard of, appeared before the Board of Parole hearings without incurring a single solitary written or verbal write-up of any form. I was, quote-unquote, a model inmate. Parole denied. Mr. Sommers, Kieth, you've done everything we told you to do. I think I speak to everybody when I say, well done. Come back in a year. I came back in 1 year. I continued to do what I was asked to do and other things I was told not to do. Parole denied. When I entered the penal system, part of those 35,000 other life inmates would frequently come up to me and go, "Hey, man, no, it's over, homie. This is the last trip, homie. We ain't getting out of here, homie. Hey, Vato Holmes, man, give it up, homie. Ain't no shit, homie. This is it, cuz. I don't want to hear that. See, I didn't do what you did. Yeah, I was still in denial. No matter how the result happened, the fact is, the result still happened. There's a person no longer alive because of me. That's all the parole board wanted to see. I got on the phone after my second parole denial. I called Mom and Dad 3,000 miles away and I said, "Mom, Dad, are you listening?" And "Yeah, no, Mom, you get that. You really need to hear me. Mom, Dad, I have 3 realities facing me. Number 1, I'm going to attempt to escape. I may get killed in the attempt. The ward will call, ask what to do. With my body, I do not care. 2, I will attempt to escape. I will succeed. You will never hear from me again. Just trust and believe that I am well. Or 3, Mom, Dad, some of the lifers are giving themselves over to this thing called studying the law, trying to learn jurisprudence and legalities and court filings and codes of civil procedure. I don't know. It seems like concocted ideas, but That's how we're doing it. While they begged and they sobbed and they cried and pleaded on the end of that 3,000-mile distance collect call, Kieth, baby, son, don't do this. Do what you have to do to keep going. Death was daily. The Crips, the Bloods, the Northsiders, the BTFs, the 415s, the Nazi lowriders, the Brotherhood, the Weimars, the Great Streets, the Long Beach Insane. Shall I go on? Every form of social disobedient association was represented in the most criminal, most violent, most racially positioned penal system in the United States of America, bar none. And I was at the top of the food chain other than the death row inmate because I was a level 4 institutional inmate. I listened to my mother and father. I didn't exercise option 1 or 2. I gave up everything in my natural life except for shitting, shaving, bathing, and studying the law. From the time I woke up to the time I closed my eyes, I studied the law. I asked my loved ones to do nothing but send in to my prison cell law books, transcripts, codes of civil and criminal procedure, how to write pleadings, how to shepherdize. And I mastered life in litigation, constitutional law, and I fought over 30 cases in the state and federal court system. And after 5 and a half more years, my challenge of that first parole denial reached the U.S. Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. And a 3-judge panel assigned to my case from the Ninth Circuit were ruling in my favor. They called then-Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger and said, do yourselves a favor. Find a way to let Kieth Sommers out of your prison, because if we declare a decision from this bench, it's going to create what's called a legal watershed. That means 7 other states, California, Arizona, Oregon, Nevada, Alaska, Hawaii, Texas, could all use my case law and get out of prison. But to keep that from happening, they took me back to the parole board in July of 2009 and found me suitable for parole. 5 months later, they sat my files on Arnold Schwarzenegger's desk for the gubernatorial review. 99% of the time is usually where the governor vetoes any grant issued by the parole board. But because of the precedent that my case was set in the U.S. Ninth Circuit, the Attorney General said, Arnold, do not touch this one. Let him go. After serving 18 years, 3 months, 8 days, convicted of murder in the second degree for a DUI fatality, I got released from Chucky's house, which is California State Prison in Corcoran, because Charles Manson was also housed. I walked out of that penal system with 18 years, 3 months, and 8 days without having incurred a single solitary disciplinary writing, verbal or written. I derived my rehabilitation through interinstitutional, inside the penal system, and outside the penal system through mail correspondence and the love and support of family and friends on the outside. February 23rd, 2011. The same 2 people I wrote the most intense, all-encompassing letters of goodbye to, my biological mother and my biological father. In 1993, while sitting on the level 4 Lancaster penal yard, saying things like, Mom, this is not your fault. See, you and Dad went against all odds as a mixed-race couple marrying in the 60s, and you gave birth to my brother and I through great sacrifice on your own. So know this, the bed that I'm in and may die in, you didn't make this for me. I made this bed because of my pride and my ego. Yes, that's right, Mom and Dad. I was the kid who, after the keg parties, would open up his blinds or his drapes and look out and see my car go, wow, how did my car get here? Or the next morning, I get out and walk around in my car and go, to my brother, did you have my car last night?
No.
Why is it parked all funny? Or after a night of drinking and drugging, the phone would ring and I'd pick it up and put it to my ear, and someone on the other end would go, Kieth, dude, do you know what you did last night? See, Mom and Dad, I thought the shit was funny. I thought it was hip, slick, and cool, you know? I was the guy that could be trusted on for a good time. I always had killer chronic. I always had a good cook. I always knew where the latest parties were, the VIPs to get people in. See, what I didn't see is the consequence of my choices. I didn't see that my obsession of fixing the pain between my ears and the depth of my heart would one day bring forth this consequence. I thought it was cool being the class clown. I thought it was cool when the teacher would send letters to my mom and dad and I'd intercept them from the mailbox when the parent-teacher conference was requested by my teachers. I couldn't see what I couldn't see. I didn't know what I didn't know. So Mom, Dad, I encourage you to please go on with your lives and find some way to do that, but this is where I'm going to be. I don't know how I'm going to survive. Death happens on a daily basis in here. So, find a way to go on. Just know that I'm going to try to be well. So, February 23rd, 2011, when over two football fields distance on Corcoran State Prison parking lot, I'm now getting to re-embrace my biological mother and father after 18 and a quarter years of being away. Words can't express what that was like. Simultaneously, I always knew the person who died November 15, 1992, his family will never have that experience because of me. Did I wake up November 14th, that Saturday, thinking I want to hurt myself or somebody else? But did I exercise the behaviors that would prevent that from happening? Absolutely not. Because all I saw was Kieth. When I was sitting in that prison cell, I was granted my release from the governor. And I knew I was going to be released 14 months later in February of 2011. I racked my brain to think of how am I going to re-engage life on life's terms. Because I did it all clean and sober, though there's drugs and alcohol in the penal system. I did it disciplinary free, I didn't act out. I didn't act in accordance to the feelings in here. I followed a moral dictate that doesn't succumb to my feelings. But see, I learned with maturity, feelings aren't facts. One more time. Feelings are not facts. The paradigm that I use, the canvas of my thoughts, are predicated in my moral certainties. I have a spiritual house. I have a physical house. I have a financial house. And I have a social house. And every single day, 7 days a week, 365 a year, I do exercise in each of my four spiritual houses. Spiritual, physical, financial, and social. See, I learned with rigorous self-confrontation that when I'm in fear, other side of anger and aggression. When I'm in depression, it's that anger turned inwardly. I learned that there's two main forms of fear. Fear of losing what I have, or fear of not getting what I think I rightfully deserve. I can't begin to count the amount of days or nights that I would cry inside my prison pillow because I didn't want to show the external signs of weakness to my fellow convicted fellow. Because they use that as weakness to capitalize on it. But in shedding those tears, I got clean. In shedding those tears, I kept myself grounded in the present and real. Because only from that perspective, only from that perception, can I process life on life's terms without altering myself from my neck up. Today I enjoy over 25 consecutive years of being clean and sober. I've encountered death of loved ones clean and sober. I've encountered hundreds of inmates at a level 4 institution sticking and stabbing and killing each other while six mini 14s are pulling the trigger as fast as they can from the guard tower. Blood squirting everywhere like a butcher bath. And I did it clean and sober. I had a conversation with another race in the center of the yard talking about things that are good, uplifting, when his head got blown off and the brain matter sprayed down my chest. And I immediately had to prone out on the ground, fingers open, so I would not register as a combatant to the guards in the tower above, and sob to myself. Clean and sober. So when Officer Clemente proceeded to tell me about some of the life situations that my brothers and sisters with an ass in the chair in this room right now are contending with, I understand. I did not believe anybody could understand what I was going through pre-November 92 when I became incarcerated with a life sentence. Because all I saw was me. When I got the vision to share my experience, strength, and hope while sitting in a prison cell, I said, who the hell is going to want to listen to me if I'm a convicted felon? Once again, I evaluated based on my insecurities and low self-esteem at that moment. In the 7 years I've been out, I've spoken hundreds of times in rooms like this, less than in capacity and far more in capacity. From 8 to 80. And the one dominant thread that translates to everybody is nobody is spared from the human experience. When I work with people like Prince, I used to look at people like that and say, wow, with all the money, all the power, all the prestige, all the talent, all the world recognition, more money than any human being needs to live a thriving life on this planet, wasn't good enough. Why would Whitney Houston leave 100,000 people in a stadium screaming her name, most of which couldn't even speak English as a native language? She would go into her dressing room, tell bodyguards like me, keep everyone the fuck away. Grab towels, stuff it under the seam of her door, shut her window, pull her blinds, and pull out a glass pipe to freebase herself and to save her. Why? Was she not beautiful? Was she not talented? Was she not successful? Why? Why Amy Winehouse? Why? I know why. Because the world will never be enough. Sex will never cure me. Money never cured me. Power, prestige, fame, had it wasn't enough. So if money, power, prestige, looks, world fame, and talent are not enough, then what is? Therein lies the answer. You are. You are. You are. You are. October 2011, I spoke at a podium very much like this in Venice, California. And after I was done speaking, a girl came up to me with tears streaming down her eyes. I asked her, I said, excuse me, why are you crying? She was incoherent. She couldn't even form words for a while. I just gave her time. When she finally mustered the composure, she then proceeded to tell me she was planning on killing herself. But after hearing my story, she decided not to. June 5th, following year, I spoke in Sepulveda, Ohio Street, in West Los Angeles. A very similar experience. A girl waited to the very end to come up and thank me for having been their keynote speaker that evening. And she proceeded to tell me with tears streaming down her face that she only came to this meeting to fulfill the promise she made to her best friend. But what her best friend and no other person on the planet knew is what she was telling me is that before she came to the meeting that day, she wrote a note and left it at home. And then she was coming to the meeting to fulfill a promise to her friend, and then she was going to go back home. But what she was going to do is, she was going to take two bottles of OxyContin and a half gallon of vodka and end her life that night. Because see, that note she mentioned was her suicide. I told her two things. Number one, the person you would have killed tonight would have been the wrong person. Because see, that perception of yourself right now is based on emotional tornado that's going on inside of you that says you're not good enough. Those who love you will be grieving and be in sorrow, but they'll be better off without you. Because all you bring them is shame, all you bring them is pain, all you bring them is torment. That's a fucking lie. And I'm saying this as a convicted felon doing 18 and a quarter years in a state penitentiary with no release date. That would be a lie. And number two, you would have taken a permanent solution to a temporary problem. See, when Kieth is in fear, when Kieth doesn't feel he's good enough, worthy enough, I know I'm future driven. I'm in the future, not in the present. Because those are comprehensions of things I'm about to encounter. When I'm in shame, when I'm in remorse, when I'm in regret, when I'm feeling less than, I'm in the past. And it's my perception, my assessment of those occurrences that are defining my current state of being. So I have to shift my warped and impaired perception to get right here, right now, in the present. Because that's where my power is. Not my power, but I become a conduit of love. Because I don't give a flying fat rat's ass what color your skin is, how much money you have, who your daddy is, not is, who your mama is, what your brother did, what your grades are, what your aspirations are, what your failures you think are. I love you anyway. Because for some reason, you have a journey to fulfill. And I heard it said, I think it was Oscar Wilde that said this, whether your story, your life story, is a success or a tragedy, it all depends on when you say cut. If you want a happy ending, walk through that pain. If you want to see what all that pain was for, ask for help. Ask for help. I'm not standing in this high school gymnasium talking to you with my past record because Kieth did this on his own. Kieth said, Father, what will you have me do? He said, speak. His brothers and sisters that are just the same pain that you were when you sat at the entranceway of your cafeteria not knowing where do you sit. Because a black kid say you're a gray boy, you're a half-breed, you're a zebra, you're a mutt. I went to more bar mitzvahs and bat mitzvahs than any Jewish person I met to the present day. My yearbook went from Abrams to Zimmerman. Baruch Adonai, Elohim, never come up, shall I go on? Everything that I've gone through prepared me for here, right now, today. I want to leave you with this one quick parable. There was a story of a farmer experiencing a flood. Jed the farmer was experiencing a flood, and the waters rose to knee height. Jed was wading in the water when his neighbors came by in rowboats and said, Jed, come on, man, get aboard. We're going to save you. Jed's like, no, go away. I got this. Leave me alone. The flood waters continued to rise. They're at mid-chest on Jed. His friends now are coming by in motorized boats. Jed, get on board, man. We're going to save you. Jed's like, no, get out of here, man. I got this. The floodwaters continue to rise. Now, Jed is holding on the antenna at the top of a hay silo, swaying back and forth at the current of the water. The Coast Guard drops a ladder from a helicopter and says, Jed, this is the Coast Guard. Grab a hold of the life. Life preserver and the ladder will pull you to safety. Jed says, no. Get out of here. I got this. Jed drowns. He goes before his neighbor and says, why didn't you let this happen? When the rowboat came by, I said, get out of here. I got this. When the powerboats came by, I said, get out of here. I got this. When the ladder dropped from the helicopter, I said, get out of here. I got this. His higher power, who we called God, said, Jed, who do you think sent you the rowboat, the yacht, and the helicopter? If anything I said to you this afternoon made sense, think about who sent you your rowboat, your yacht, and your helicopter. Thank you for letting me share my experience during the film with you guys.
Thank you so much for coming and sharing. Guys, I want you guys to take a second, collect yourselves. You guys are dismissed at this time to head over to your fourth period class. And if you guys have any questions, you guys want to come up and talk to Kieth, you're definitely welcome to as well. Thank you, guys.